in this incredible ballroom here at the Waldorf Astoria in the heart of Rome. When I say the heart of Rome, we're above Rome, and when we wake up, we look out at one of the most incredible cities in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, can we give a big round of applause to everyone who's going to talk to you, and you're going to get involved. This is the scene here. Come on, everybody, let's have a big round of applause. Let's get going. Our thanks to Emirates for bringing us all here from all corners of the earth, and we have literally people from nearly 100 countries who've flown here for the next 4 days of pure entertainment to find out what we can do for purebred Arabian racing. It's good to be here, and the man who has sorted all this is the ambassador. So please welcome, and can we give a big round of applause to His Excellency the UAE Ambassador to Rome. It is the one and only Saka Al-Raisi. Please, sir, come and join us live on stage. And thank you for last night. Absolutely superb. The Vatican was wonderful. Sir, yours.
Thank you for your good to see you.
صباح الخير السلام عليكم جميعا. سعيدين أن نلتقي المرة الثانية. الثالثة والرابعة في خلال الأيام القادمة. أصحاب السعادة، السيدات والسادة، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بالأصالة عن نفسي وبالإنابة عن جميع أعضاء السفارة دولة الإمارات العربية المتحدة في إيطاليا، يسرني أن أفتتح المؤتمر العالمي السابع لسباقات الخيول العربية والمقام في روما. إننا سعداء بتواجدكم معنا ومشاركتكم في هذا المحفل العالمي، فالشكر موصول لمن كان سبباً في إقامته هنا، سمو الشيخ منصور بن زايد آل نهيان نائب رئيس مجلس الوزراء وزير شؤون الرئاسة، حفظه الله. بفضل توجيهاته السديدة ودعمه اللامحدود لسباقات الخيول العربية، أصبحت الخيول العربية وسباقاتها تنافس كبرى البطولات العالمية، وهذا ليس بغريب على سموه الذي نهل من مدرسة والده المغفور له بإذن الله الشيخ زايد بن سلطان آل نهيان طيب الله ثراه، الذي أرسى ورسخ تراث الآباء والأجداد بالاهتمام بالخيول العربية وسباقاتها. وتحية تقدير وإعجاب للدور الرائع الذي لعبته وتلعبه أم الإمارات سمو الشيخة فاطمة بنت مبارك في دعم رياضة المرأة في دولة الإمارات والعالم جميع، مما أثمر عن تحقيق العديد من الإنجازات المدوية عالميا. السيدات والسادة، إن دولة الإمارات بفضل التوجيهات السديدة والدعم اللامحدود من قيادتها الرشيدة وعلى رأسهم صاحب السمو الشيخ خليفة بن زايد آل نهيان رئيس الدولة حفظه الله، وأخيه صاحب السمو الشيخ محمد بن راشد آل مكتوم نائب رئيس الدولة رئيس مجلس الوزراء حاكم دبي رعاه الله وأخوانهما أعضاء المجلس الأعلى للحكام، وصاحب السمو الشيخ محمد بن زايد آل نهيان ولي عهد أبو ظبي نائب القائد الأعلى للقوات المسلحة، أضحت تلعب دوراً هاماً ومحورياً في نشر السلام وروح التسامح وتقبل الآخر في كافة مناشط الحياة عامة والرياضة خاصة، لأنها تمثل الطريق الأسرع والأمثل لنشر هذه الثقافات عالمياً. ختاماً يسعدني أن أتقدم بالشكر الجزيل للقائمين على تنظيم هذا الحدث العالمي وعلى رأسهم السيدة لارا صوايا المدير التنفيذي للمهرجان الشيخ منصور للخيول العربية وفريق عملها الذين واصلوا الليل بالنهار لإظهار هذا المؤتمر في أبهى صورة، والشكر موصول لأجهزة الإعلام المرئية والمسموعة والمقروءة لتغطيتها الرائعة لفعاليات المؤتمر. تمنياتي لجميع المشاركين من ملاك ومربين ولاعبين بالتوفيق والنجاح، متمنين لكم مؤتمرا ناجحا وبطولة رائعة بكل المقاييس، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Thank you, sir.
Superb. Thank you very much indeed. Right, let's move on, because the next guy on stage, he was the first man here, which is incredible, the chairman of the International Federation of Arabian Horse Racing. Please welcome Sami Albuainin. Sami, come and join us. Good morning. Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Lovely. You. Ladies and gentlemen, Sami Albuainin.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. On behalf of the International Federation, IFAR, the Arab Horse Racing Authorities, I would like to thank you for being here for the beautiful conference. We've been all over the world in this conference, and it seems to look bigger and bigger and more expert they attend. That's because of the support. And it's an honor to have support of His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan for the Arabian horses and for the IFAR and IFAR country members. And also I would like to thank Her Highness Sheikha Fatma bint Mubarak for all her support for ladies' sport and especially for the girls' racing all over the world. And we have world championship of girls every year because of Her Highness support. This conference, it really looks, there is big step forward for the Arabian horses. We have seen a lot, we have met a lot of people, they have a lot of experience. That's because also the wonderful Lara Sawaya, the manager, the one, the head behind all of this, she get everybody together and she invite everybody who have really good experience to attend this conference. And it's an honor to be here. And thank you very much. And also, I don't want to forget the United Arab Emirates. United Arab Emirates, they support Arabian horses for so many years. And the Arabian horse racing now, it's in the top. And everywhere, there is many countries before they don't have Arabian horses, now they do. And they have racing, and also they have group races, they have listed races, which is beautiful. Thank you, United Arab Emirates. Thank you, Your Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan. And thank you, Your Highness Sheikh Fatma bint Mubarak. And thank you all, guys. Thank you.
You are a star. Brilliant. He's a great guy, he travels the world, and he's a great supporter and obviously promoter of purebred Arabian racing. Last night was incredible, I think, for all of us. A lot of us have been to many places around the world, but last night we went to the home of the Pope, the Vatican. It was incredible. But what was very moving were the speeches that were made when you saw the UAE flag flying above the Vatican. I know it meant a lot for so many people here and around the world. A man who impressed me very much with his words, I'd like him to come on now. He is the man who's in charge of the UAE archives. Please welcome and give him a big round of applause, because this guy is incredible. Dr. Abdullah Al-Raisi. He made a speech last night which really moved a lot of people to tears. It was very moving. And I'd like to say thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Doc, over to you.
Buongiorno, everybody. His Excellency, my dear brother, Saqer bin Nasser al-Raisi, UAE Ambassador to Italy. His Excellency, Sami Albuainin, Chairman of IFAR. Their Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor always to stand before you and to deliver sometimes long speeches, sometimes short speeches. Today, I think we have a heavy agenda, so my speech will be very short. Today, His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Arabian Horses Festival reaching its seventh star. So congratulations to all in this wonderful festival. And congratulations to my boss, His Highness Sheikh Mansour, for reaching the seventh star today. For many years, I have worked with His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan. And I know how he plans when he puts his hand in any activity. The first thing, he has a strategy. He never works without any clear vision or strategy. And he starts with a legal aspect of any organization, which is very important to our work. Then there is a constitution, there is a strategic plan to reach to the excellence. Today we are celebrating all the excellence in the Arabian horse races. We are all proud. You should be all proud of your achievements. I was thinking last night, after we came back from the Vatican and the messages everyone sent to the Vatican and to the world, that UAE now leading the world in peace, tolerance, and accepting others, respecting each other. These terminologies, they are all in practice already in UAE. All of you visited UAE and you know these terminologies very well. You know that 90% of total UAE population come from more than 200 different nationalities, and they are all living in peace and harmony together. We are all proud of this achievement. It could not have been done alone as leaders, but also everyone living in UAE. It is not strange that these principles, the guiding principles, it's all started with the father of the nation, belated Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, peace be upon his soul, that he spread peace among nations, and his vision for humanity and mankind was very clear. He gathered people around him believing in one thing, that what we have resources in UAE should be given to all people without asking. All in UAE are proud of these achievements. We are proud of current leadership who are following the same path of Sheikh Zayed. 46 years of great achievements. If you count 46 years in the life of any country, it's nothing. These are only a few years passed with a blink of eyes. But today, we are proud that the Arabian horses made its march to the Vatican yesterday. And for the first time, we see the UAE flag raised in that sacred place. It made all of us proud. I came back home and sending messages to all colleagues, all friends, all family members in UAE and around the world, what happened yesterday. You should be proud of your achievement. You should be proud in the Arabian horses that marched into the Vatican. We were divided, we are united. Thank you, Italy. Thank the United Arab Emirates. God bless you all.
Wow, follow that. Oof, it was special. And the man who's going to follow that, let's give a big round of applause. He's the boss of Abu Dhabi Tourism. It is Mubarak Al Naimi. Come and join us live on stage. The man who sends the message of Abu Dhabi around the world. And whether it's promoting purebred Arabian horses or Hollywood films like Fast and Furious, and I loved that bit when they went from one skyscraper to the other. Good to see you.
Thanks.
Please join us.
Assalamu alaikum. First of all, I would like to thank you all for coming here today. And on behalf of Abu Dhabi Tourism and Culture Authority, I would like to thank His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed and Her Highness Sheikha Fatma to give us the opportunity to be part of this conference. We are all proud to see Abu Dhabi everywhere today. And this is, believe me guys, this is something very great achievement. And we should always be proud, and we should be always be so happy. I would like to thank again everybody who have been part of this achievement, and especially Lara Sawaya, and with all her, I mean, hard work and achievement. We are so glad, and we, again, I cannot say more than what my colleagues say today. We should be always glad and happy to see Abu Dhabi on the map of the whole world. How, I mean, what kind of achievement we've been done in the past and today. Thank you again. Bye-bye.
Well, it's always been an ambition of mine to come to Rome, the home of Frankie Dettori and Andrea Azzini, who come from Italy, and they're pretty good at football as well. And we're going to see how good they are on the race course at the Campanella. And it's lovely to be here, so please welcome now the first of our hosts. And she is a lovely lady. She is the Minister of Agriculture, and this is going to be good. Stefania Mastromarino. I hope I got it right. Did I get anywhere near? Did I do all right? I did. See you later.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. On behalf of the Italian Ministry of the Agriculture, it's my pleasure to give you all our welcome in Rome. First of all, I would like to thank His Royal Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan for his trust in Italy. In fact, although Italy has recently joined IFAR, it has been chosen to host this important event. I would also like to thank Lara Sawaya, the tireless Lara Sawaya, to having made all this possible. We have strongly wanted to become a recognized member to this great community, because Italy has horse raising and horse breeding important traditions. This result is for Italy a very great. We are definitely aware that we have a lot to learn, very lot, but we will keep working with the highest commitment to achieve our common goal. We consider this partnership as a strategic for the future of the Italian horse raising and horse breeding. Moreover, this is for us an opportunity, a tremendous opportunity, to exchange our experience in purebred Arabian horses and international races with such a competent environment. Despite our experience is still lower than other countries in this area, we hope that Italian contribution can be an incentive and an added value to breeding and organization spectacular international races. This is our aim. We believe that a participatory discussion and attitude of listening are the best way to continue to learn and to prepare the upcoming future. Thank you.
Now, if I said Leonardo DiCaprio was in the building, you'd start getting excited, wouldn't you? The world's most famous actor, and of course we were at the Hollywood a few weeks ago when we had the DALI Awards, and Leonardo DiCaprio won the main award. We have today, live on stage, Danilo DiCaprio. Come and join us. He is the executive director of the racing here in Italy. And of course, you must be the younger brother, presumably. Ladies and gentlemen, over to you.
His Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Hippo Group Roma Capannelli, it's a great pleasure and the honor to give the hospitality of the Sheikh Mansour Festival in the our race course. We are proud to be host race course for this festival and for this three Arabian race in Capannelle. I give you a short details of the Sunday. The Sunday, the race day, will be held Emirates Day, but will be a family day because we are set up in the our VIP garden, the playground for child. So we hope to enjoy during this day in Capannelle. The first race and the race day start at 2:30, but only tomorrow after the running declaration we have the right time of the race. As mentioned yesterday in the press conference, I hope that Sunday race will be the beginning of the strength relationship with my company and the Sheikh Mansour Festival. And so for the reason I'd like a warm thanks for the support and for the friendship to Ms. Lara Savala and the ambassador of the UAE, Mr. Saghir Al-Raisi. So we hope to see you at Capannelle Race Course Sunday, and I wish you a good day with the World Conference in Rome. Thanks.
There's also somebody else that I'd like to welcome. Two more speeches before we get underway with the first seminar. And this is the person who runs the Italian breeding of purebred Arabians. Please welcome live on stage, Francesco Santoro.
Good morning to everybody. Excellency, ladies and gentlemen. Mi scuso se parlo in italiano, ma non vorrei che I miei ringraziamenti perdessero valore con il mio pessimo inglese. Il mio nome è Francesco Santoro, sono da circa 20 anni il presidente dell'Associazione Nazionale del Cavallo Puro Sangue Arabo Italiano e con immenso piacere oggi sono qui tra di voi rappresentando circa 1200 allevatori e un libro genealogico che contiene oggi più di 21.000 soggetti iscritti. È il mio grande piacere darvi il benvenuto a Roma, dare il benvenuto a questo festival di Sua Altezza Reale Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan e alla sua direttrice Lara Sawaya che hanno ideato e reso possibile questa World Arabian Horse Racing Conference. Il mio saluto va a tutte le persone presenti e a tutti e porto il saluto di tutti gli allevatori italiani del puro sangue arabo. L'Italia si è affacciata verso gli anni 90 al mondo delle corse del puro sangue arabo per l'iniziativa e la passione di alcuni soci che in quegli anni là incominciarono a organizzare le prime corse del cavallo puro sangue arabo in Italia. Ho il dovere oggi di ricordare alcuni personaggi che hanno reso possibile questa realtà e tra primi il signor Arnaldo Rosatini, un vecchio socio che fu il primo allevatore italiano a iniziare le corse del cavallo puro sangue arabo in Italia e che cominciò in sinergia con il Ministero delle Agricolture e Foreste il percorso lungo che ci ha portato oggi qui. Un altro ringraziamento devo farlo a un amico che insieme a me per circa 20 anni è stato segretario dell'ANICA, il signor Pierluigi Rota, il quale oltre ad essere in gioventù un jockey è stato un importante allevatore di cavalli puro sangue arabi da corsa. Il ringraziamento va anche a Sua Altezza Reale Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed, che ha deciso di ospitare questa conferenza qui in Roma. Un altro gruppo di allevatori di puro sangue arabo che della Sardegna sono stati molto a sangue arabo, e a loro va il mio ringraziamento per il lavoro svolto con il Ministero, anche loro, per arrivare a questo risultato e a questo successo. E senza il suo impegno e senza il suo aiuto e la sua professionalità non avremmo sicuramente facilmente ottenuto i successi che ora abbiamo avuto. La Sheikh Zayed Cup, i campionati del mondo Sheikh Fatima bint Mubarak. Auguro a tutti voi un buon soggiorno a Roma e auguro a tutti voi un buon lavoro nelle varie commissioni. Grazie.
On board, but there is one very special. You see over there, One World, Six Continents, Abu Dhabi, the capital. And our thanks to them for not just supporting this, but for supporting us wherever we go around the world. Please welcome their marketing executive live on stage, Ms. Khulid Al-Nouemi. Thank you very much indeed for coming, as always. And we save the best to the last. It's all yours. Enjoy.
Good morning, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the National Feed and Flower Production and Marketing, we are delighted and honored to be an associate partner to the 7th World Arabian Horse Racing Conference under His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan. I wish to extend a warm welcome to our fellow envoys from the various countries around the world. I realize that you are fully dedicated to the sessions that will be followed, but I do hope you will also take the time to enjoy your stay among the very friendly participants. I would like to express my gratitude to all delegates for their fully cooperation and contribution to the World Arabian Horse Racing Conference, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank the joint organizer of His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan Festival for organizing this event and for providing the necessary support with such pleasant hospitality, especially Miss Lara, the Iron Woman. And I would like also to thank the mother of the world, Sheikh Fatima bint Mubarak, for her unlimited support and for the UAE Embassy in Italy. Thank you a lot.
Speeches, and now we come to our first session. It is the breeding session. We're going to go back to Saud in the studio, and in 5 minutes' time, rejoin us, whether you're watching on Yes TV or the Sheikh Mansour feed around the world. We're live for the 2016 World Purebred Arabian Conference. Stay with us. Right, guys, we're just going to get rid of the lectern. Could we have all the delegates on stage, please, now for our first session? Thank you. Girls, just watch out. Just move to either side, if you wouldn't mind. We're going to get rid of this. Yes, it is now time to start. Racetrack, whoever wins, whoever loses. It's all about where it starts. And it starts when you have a stallion, but which stallion to use? It all starts when you have a mare, but which mare and which stallion? And also, what sort of start can you give them in life when they're pregnant, but also when they're born, when they're young foals? So what can you do, whether you're a multi-millionaire with thousands of acres and lots of horses, or whether you're a person who's just got one mare that you love the sport, how can you turn their offspring into a potential big race winner? Well, we've got some of the top racing brains behind us live on stage, and I'd like to introduce you to them now. We're going to start with the gentleman nearest to me, and this is a man from Scotland, but he's worked for most of his life in the UAE. He is one of the top vets in the world. A big round of applause, please, for Andrew Dalgleish. It's lovely to have a local boy made good. His family have been breeding horses in Italy for years. And this gentleman is one of the top vets as well in the world. And he's now residing in the UAE. Please welcome the local kid who made good, Stefano Daneri. The next girl along comes from Germany, but she lives not far from me in Newmarket. She's a qualified vet, but she's also a very successful racehorse trainer of thoroughbreds and purebred Arabians. And a five-year-old son, who is actually English, speaks Arabic better than a lot of people I know. Please welcome Ilka Gansera Levesque. 2 months ago, we were live in Hollywood. We had the Darleys. And American racing for the purebred Arabians. Oh, we've got some of the best horses in the world, if not the greatest horse in the world. We have, I'm pleased to say, the boss of the American Jockey Club. Please welcome from America, Kathy Smoke. A lady who does so much to promote Italian horses, purebred Arabians around the world, and she has played such an important part in us being here. We're going to find out more about what we can do and what they can do for us. Please welcome, representing Italy, Annalisa Landucci. Our next gentleman is a professor from Budapest in Hungary. His company has invented something that could take off in a big way. It's called, well, he's going to tell us more, but assisted reproduction. Please welcome Professor Saba Prebensky. This lady here is from the United Kingdom. She lives just outside Newmarket. And her role is what you put into horses, food-wise, to make them bigger, stronger, and faster. We'll be hearing more from this lady, Kath Dunnett. And finally, from Morocco, one of the top guys, he goes with us around the world, a Morocco play host to one of the rounds of the Sheikha Fatima World Series every year. And of course, they're great at producing some of the best purebred Arabians. Please welcome, from Morocco, Ezeldina Sodrati. Right, well, come on, I'm going to start with this end, all right? Andrew, come on, let's start. The question for you all, and remember, if you have a question anywhere, put your hand up, the girls will come. If you want to ask a question any time during the next session, please put your hand up, wave your hand, and we'll come and see you. But come on, Andrew, tell us more. What is the best way? Whether you're a multimillionaire or someone with one horse, how do you breed a horse that could be a champion? The mic doesn't seem to be working, so use mine while we get that sorted. Okay.
Sorry, thank you. Yes, so again, I'm saying how much I appreciate to be here, and I'd like to thank my boss for 20 years, sir, and also to Lara. Hello? Yeah. Okay. So the question is, you have a mare and you want to breed. With the Arabians, you're very lucky. If, as long as you have a good mare, you have all the best stallions, racing stallions, available to you. And because of assisted breeding technology, which Dr. Saba will talk about, we have the ability to import semen from different countries, to inseminate your mare, to produce your foal, and then you have your own input into rearing your foal and training your foal and producing a good horse. Last month I was in Ireland, and I was lucky to visit Coolmore Stud. And there, of course, they don't use any assisted breeding. So therefore, the stallions have to, though they're very valuable stallions, and you know, all horses are fragile, they have to be exposed to the mares 3 times a day, you know, for breeding. If they want to breed in the Southern Hemisphere, they have to take the horse to the Southern Hemisphere, whereas the Arabians, we can send the semen from the UE or from France or from the UK to the Southern Hemisphere. So, you know, in Arabians, we really have a lot of advantages, and we can do a lot thanks to that.
Super. I'll take the microphone.
Sorry, yeah.
Thank you. That's mine. Sir, what are your thoughts?
So, I don't know if they can hear me.
Guys, are we on the mics? They
it
should
fine.
Be. Just keep
okay.
trying.
I personally think that to breed the perfect race horse is the dream of every breeder. And personally, I believe that there are three main stages doing this. It's planning your mating, that is the dream and the target of every breeder, because we love to think about which stallion to mate to our mare. Second, to get your mare in foal and the time of the pregnancy. And third, and most, a very important one, is to raising your horse. I think that each of these three stages has some fundamental meanings, because you have to choose the right mating, and it doesn't necessarily mean to mate the most expensive stallion to your mare, but I think each breeder should think about choosing the stallion that better can improve your mare. And when I say this, I personally, as a breeder, I think not that much about the performances of the stallion, but if it's possible, I look at what the stallion produce and what are the characteristics of the production of the stallion. If they mate, the needs and the production of my mare. Secondly, is to get your mare in foal. The first stage, I think, is demanded mainly to the breeder, okay? Because this is why we breed. Because one day we want to say, this is a champion, he's an outstanding horse, came from me, from my mind. So something we create. Second stage is to get your mare in foal and keep the pregnancies. This is a very important part, and some people lack in some knowledge about this, but this can be supported by professional people and science. I think that what the baby is missing when it's inside the belly of the mom is not going to get after. And third is raising the baby in the right environment, because we have to consider that we are breeding an athlete, we are not breeding a pleasure horse, which means the needs and the necessities of these horses are peculiar, and we need to fulfill the needs of the baby, thinking about raising a future athlete.
Interesting. You're listening to all this. Okay, what are your thoughts after that?
First of all, I have to say thank you for inviting me to this great panel, and it's an honor to be on a panel with such great delegates, and also to be on a breeding panel in Italy, where Tezio wrote, one of the greatest breeders anyway in thoroughbred breeding, so it's a great honor to be on a breeding panel in Italy. I think with breeding, it's all about, if you start doing the pedigree analysis, it's all about compatibility, and like Dr. Daglish said, the mare is the main important, like the key factor there. And the difference between thoroughbred breeding and Arabian breeding is that there's so much more, they're so much closely inbred, and there's such a shortage of good mare bloodlines, so it's great to be on, for this conference to take place, so we can preserve these bloodlines, you know, because it's so much more inbred than thoroughbred breeding, but it's all about compatibilities, and really planning that ahead. And not just saying, I have a good mare, and if you send it to the wrong stallion, it doesn't. Or if you are a stallion owner, to make a stallion career, you really need to make sure he gets the right mares that are compatible to him to make his stallion future.
How do you make them compatible? I mean, this is the thing, Kathy, I'd like to bring you in here. You know, if we've got a superstar stallion, we want to all send our mares to that. Or does it not work like that?
In my case, I'm probably representative of the small breeder. And first and foremost, it's important that everybody understand that Sheikh Mansour Festival, he takes care of everyone, not just the stakes horses, but through his Wathba Stud Farm Cup. All the small breeders get an opportunity to showcase their horses, because the smaller breeders like myself who breed one, maybe two a year, you know, once again, you have to look for a stallion that will complement your mare. But more importantly, you have to do a lot of homework, because unlike the thoroughbred world, we don't have the nicks that are published, like there are in the United States for the thoroughbreds. This horse is nicked with, this stallion is nicked with this mare, and this is how many offspring have done well. We have to do homework. We have to listen to the veterinarians who handle the Arabians. We have to listen to other breeders. We have to read. You have to really work at finding the right stallion for your mare, not just for phenotype, but for genotype as well. I mean, it's not always breeding to the best, because sometimes you can't afford to go to that stallion when you're a small breeder. So what you have to look for is one that is strong in genetically, that when you look at his babies, that they have a continuity, knowing full well that they're being bred to numerous mares of numerous bloodlines. And so that's what I look for.
Very interesting, Kathy. Annalisa, I'd like to introduce you. It's good to have you here. What are your thoughts?
Sono molto difficili queste domande. Il tempo è molto lungo prima che un puledro arriva a vincere la corsa della vita o la bella corsa o la corsa più ricca del mondo, tipo quella che ci sarà ad Abu Dhabi. Tutti gli allevatori ambiscono ad avere un crack, diciamo noi in Italia, un vero cavallo da corsa, ma il tempo è molto lungo. Sappiamo tutti quanto tempo ci vuole. Hanno detto già praticamente tutto chi mi ha preceduto. Posso dire che per quello che riguarda il nostro di allevamento, come tutti gli allevamenti, parte da una genealogia, dallo studio. In Italia i cavalli arabi da corsa sono cominciati ad arrivare nel 1874. Parliamo di moltissimi anni fa. Non abbiamo cominciato ieri. Nonostante questo non siamo ancora arrivati ad avere il massimo dei cavalli. Ci mancava di confrontarci con i cavalli internazionali, con i cavalli del mondo allevatoriale già più avanti di noi. Abbiamo avuto varie peripezie, ora siamo qui in attesa di riprendere tutto il nostro allevamento e la fiducia degli allevatori italiani che hanno negli sponsor, in questo festival, in questi auspici di auguri e di promesse che noi cercheremo di raggiungere, e auguro il meglio all'allevamento italiano.
Sounds good. Thank you. I really enjoyed that. It was good. By the way, if people are watching on TV, we have the interpreters at the back, and it is lovely. We have them interpreting into English, into Arabic, into Italian. It is wonderful. So we have five, and they are outstanding, the ladies and gentlemen of the interpreters. This man doesn't need an interpreter because he is a professor. I know, Professor, we're going to talk later about your presentation, but just tell us about your groundbreaking methods which you have introduced over the past year or two.
Thank you very much. First, I would like to thank for this opportunity that I can be here and share information with you. Of course, getting the perfect offspring, it is all down to breeding. And the most important thing is the right match. To take the perfect bloodline from the mare and match it with the perfect stallion. But the most important thing is in the background, that's the genes. What is coming from the sperm and what's coming from the egg, from the oocyte. What we do basically is we preserve these genes. The preservation of these genes are very, very important. Of course, you want to preserve them for the future. If there is inbreeding, you can always go back to that gene which is preserved in liquid nitrogen tank, and you can use it any time and anywhere. It also breaks down the boundaries of time and space. If you have an excellent stud, like in Budapest, where I'm coming from, I want to use it in Brazil, it's quite easy to take a frozen semen sample and transfer it to Brazil, and the stud can stay in Budapest. So what we do is preserving these genes to the best, preserving their function so that they can achieve the perfect pregnancy rate, and also they can improve the genetics of the foal which is coming out. And if I have my word, maybe 10 minutes during the discussion, I can be more deep in this.
We are very, very much looking forward to this. He's going to do a 10-minute showcase on this presentation. I'd like to bring in Kath at the end, because we're talking about what we can do for foals, pregnant mares, stallions. What difference does the feed make? What are your thoughts?
Okay. Again, I just want to say thank you to the organizers for inviting me to be part of this very esteemed panel. I think with the feeding, it starts very early on, long before the foal is born. We're setting the stage for the foal's growth and development very early on in pregnancy. And I think when we're talking about Arabians, we need to firstly appreciate their different metabolism, and we need to modify their feeding regimes to take account of that. Quite often they do very well from their feed, and because the micronutrients that are required in such small levels are so important for supporting growth, it's important that we get that balance between energy and nutrient density right. Quite often I've been in situations where thoroughbreds and Arabians are in the same situation, in the same environment, and we find that sometimes even an excess of grass can be an issue with the Arabians, and so it's being able to control that and then feeding accordingly so that you make sure that the ration is balanced and that you're giving the young stock the best opportunity for growth. And then also if you're restricting the grazing, you obviously need to think about those things that we need to put back to make sure that those micronutrients are covered.
It's very interesting indeed. Basically, just go to National Feed and Flour because they've got everything they have. I've seen it. It's wonderful. And Sarah at the very end, representing Morocco, Ezzeldine Sidrati. So what are your thoughts after having listened for the past 10 minutes? Over to you.
Thank you very much. First, I would like to thank Ms. Lara Sawaya to be the link between the hundreds of countries who are here in the same goal, Arabian racehorse. Thanks to Sheikh Zayed in the past, thanks to Sheikh Mansour today. So to speak about breeding is a very, it takes days to speak about that. But what is important is to make in our breeding one world. To make it one world means that the genetics must be known by all the countries and followed by all the countries to make successful our stallions. As you say about Coolmore, when you have a stallion, you need a minimum of 100 mares to know about your stallion. If you don't have, it means you can lose a very good stallion because he couldn't have enough mares. In our business, it's also possible to speak about foal sharing. Foal sharing is something which exists in UK and in the States, which makes the best stallions with the best mares had a chance to meet somewhere. So it's important to find a way to do that kind of breeding in the Arabian horses. On the top of that, it is necessary today, with the big job which has been done during the last years by Lara Sawaya, one day to have an international Arabian racehorse stud book to know what is done everywhere in the world, to speak with all the countries and to find a way to cooperate. So it's a long discussion about that. That's for the breeding. The breeding of the future, I think, will be more faster due to artificial insemination and embryo transfer. And it's good that way because we are very late regarding to the thoroughbred business, which has more than 2.5 centuries history. But in our field, we don't have more than 50 real years. So all the stallions and all the mares are still not selected the best way. We still have some accident with tendons, with other problems, because the tissues are not selected on races. So it's a big discussion about the genetics we can do. Thank you.
Thank you very much for speaking so eloquently. And of course, we're talking about thoroughbreds. Every thoroughbred running around the world today, whether it's in Newmarket in England, Newmarket in Australia, San Francisco, you name it, Paris, wherever, they are all direct descendants of purebred Arabians. So it all comes from us. You've heard from all of the panelists. Now I'd like to bring on the professor. Sir, would you like to give us your little presentation? Because we'd like to hear it live.
Okay, thank you. Can Can we start the slideshow, please? Derek, can I stand up? I go.
Yes, of course, please. Take the stand.
So the title of this short presentation is Better Forth from Better Genetic Material. Because no matter what we do with breeding, it is genetics which is the most important thing. I'm from Hungary. We are a horsey nation. We came to Hungary more than 1,500 years ago on a horseback. So we pretty much know what is horse breeding and how to fight on horseback. And it's in our blood. So we know, and we know, that genetic is extremely important. If you take the Arabic horses, they are the most precious ones on the world, on the universe. Arabian is the oldest horse breed, with the most important traits fixed in the breed. They are excellent with men. They are extremely good-natured, quick to learn. They have a high spirit. They have willingness and sensitivity. All of these excellent traits are preserved in the genes, and we don't want to lose them. We want to keep them. And one of the tools to preserve genes is to take them, get the sperm from the stud, or get the oocyte from the mare, or get the embryo from the mare, and cryopreserve it. Put it in liquid nitrogen storage. It is extremely important on two ways. Thing one, we preserve the genes. We can go back to that anytime. We can take an excellent stud, cryopreserve the semen, put it in a liquid nitrogen tank, and maybe 10 years later, we know that we need that gene. We need to introduce back into our breeding. So we have the opportunity, we have the tool to take that gene back and put it back to and use it again. So it's extremely important for gene preservation. It is used in endangered species as well all over the world. It is used in human when we are having problems with conceiving and having a baby. It's an excellent tool which has been established. Also, it's quite important that in the natural breeding procedure, one stud can produce one foal from one ejaculate. But if I take that ejaculate, take that sperm, examine it, dilute it, I can use one ejaculate to inseminate many mares. It means that I can multiply the use of a very, very valuable gene pool. And third, which is, I think, one of the most important things in breeding, is that with using artificial insemination, with using sperm freezing, sperm cryopreservation, I don't need the mare to be in the same place as the stud. I can use the stud in Rome, take the semen, cryopreserve it, put it in a small liquid nitrogen tank, and send it to US, for example, where they take it out, thaw it, and they put it in the mare. And we have a foal out of that, without all the burdens of traveling and all the burdens of possible infections and things like that. So these techniques, they have quite a few upsides, which is written down there. But of course, they have some downsides as well. When I put a valuable cell, like a sperm, into liquid nitrogen, it is minus 196 degrees, quite a few cells are dying, because it's a big shock for them. If they survive, they might have DNA damage. If they survive, they might have some loss of function. So it's quite important that the upsides and downsides as well. We all know that these procedures have been published more than like 40 years ago. It is well established. Everybody was polishing the techniques of cryopreservation for decades. So basically, there is no room for big improvement in polishing the procedures. But what if we can prepare the sperm, the cells, so that they will survive better? What if we have the tool to make the cells stronger, to train them like horses? What if we can improve the function? And for all of these questions, we have an answer, which have been published widely already in different fields. I can take a cell, I can treat it, I can evoke the internal capacity of the cell, and whatever I do with that cell afterwards, like cryopreserve it, the cell will survive better. The cell will behave better. The cell will keep the functions a lot better. And this is what I would like to talk about. But first, I would like to stop for a moment. If you guys have any questions about assisted techniques, assisted reproduction, or insemination. Are you comfortable now? So there is a tool which we can use, and which is being used in all over the world in different aspects, to get that cell and treat it, and to trigger the cell's tolerance before I freeze that cell. It is published as pressure-triggered acquisition of tolerance. I treat a cell, and the cell will trigger its inner capacity to get stronger, to survive better, no matter what comes after it. What is coming out of it? The cells will preserve better the genetic material. The semen quality will be improved substantially. It also increases the survival of the sperm, but more importantly, it ensures the cell function, that it is maintained. It is also ensures the genetic material that is maintained and kept well. I don't know who of you is involved in semen cryopreservation or embryo cryopreservation, but it's a very, very old procedure. It has been established, it is used huge amount of cases in the horse, in the human, in the bovine, all over the world. There's a simple procedure, and we do the treatment of the cell, the preconditioning of the cell, of the semen, in the procedure, before the actual cryopreservation step. It's an add-on technology, basically. It's like a brick, which I put it in the line of the cryopreservation procedure.
Sir, one second, you have to do it into microphone so people can hear. Ali?
Yeah. The procedure you're talking about, is it a proposed thing to be done, or it's a practice which is being followed now?
In many areas it is done. It is done in embryo cryopreservation in institutes in Spain, in the US, in Brazil, in New Zealand. It is used. In the horse breeding, it has been just started. The first experiment was done in Hannover a couple of years back, like the safety experiments, and with a big gene preservation institute, we did a huge experiment in the last year.
So this is something new to be followed?
Yes, the technique is established, but it is now being introduced in the horse breeding.
May I ask Dr. Andrew later to comment on this, please?
Very good question. Thank you very much indeed. We flew back the other day from a race meeting and we had a good journey home. Sir, are you finished or can we push this out?
Can I get two more minutes?
Of course you can.
Okay, thank you. One of the things how we can check if the sperm is better, if it is moving better. It's only one thing, but this is quite visible. It's an example, the graph behind me is that we take an individual sperm of an Arabic horse, treat it or not treat it, cryopreserve it, and then thaw it, take it out from the cryopreservation and check how the cells are surviving. One of the things that we check is how they move. And what you can see on the graphs, it's an example of 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 horses, we can see a nice improvement in semen motility. But it's only one thing, motility. That's what we can see. What we cannot see with the eye is how the genes are preserved in the background. So if the cells are moving better, if the genes are preserved better, it means that we can achieve a higher pregnancy rate. And since the genes, the DNA, is preserved better, we can expect to have a better fall out of it. And there are quite a few more promises which we can discuss all in person. This is a well-established technology. It has been published in cloning, in embryo cryopreservation, in sperm cryopreservation, in stem cells as well. It has been presented all over the world in many, many congresses. Quite a few patents are around it. So this has been established, and it's quite new in the horse business. But we hope that it can create a big value in the horse business. And with this, I would like to thank you for the attention. And
thank you very much.
Looking forward to getting questions from you.
Very interesting. Andrew Dalglish, your immediate reaction to that?
Yes, it's... is my microphone working? Yes.
We can hear you.
Yes, it's very interesting. As you know, breeding... or most of you, I guess, with breeding with frozen semen is much more difficult than with fresh semen, because fresh semen basically has a life of about at least 48 hours, whereas frozen semen only 6 hours. So we must basically inseminate the horse very close to either just before or just after ovulation, which is very difficult to tell exactly. So you basically have to keep checking the mare by palpating her, ultrasound examination, you know, every 6 hours when she's getting close, in order to get the best results. And even then, you still don't get as good results as with fresh semen. So anything, any proven technology which can improve this, the fertility of frozen semen is obviously good. And the, you know, again, with frozen semen, some stallions seem to, their semen freezes well, and they are more, their fertility can be similar to fresh semen, whereas others, it isn't. So any technology which is proven to improve it, it is a good thing. Yeah.
Stefano.
I think it will represent a big step forward in the artificial insemination, especially helping us in being able to freeze those stallions that at the moment, due to the quality of the semen, we consider not freezable. So maybe this could help us improve in that. So we'll see, time will tell us for sure.
The gentleman from Morocco, you want to come in on this?
Yes, I'm interested in that field because we have a lab of artificial insemination and embryo transfer. I think the biggest problem we have is not to fix actually a good frozen semen. We have more difficulties to have the right mares to breed the Arabian horses because we need to have good mares, but not too big for the race horses. We need the right mares to do the embryo transfer. So it's not easy to do it with the thoroughbred mares, but it's better to do it now with Anglo-Arabs or trotters to have the right mares to do the embryo transfer. I think in many countries they do the embryo transfer and it will help to develop more faster the Arabian horses. And the frozen semen is now beginning to bring the result of the development of the Arab horses. For instance, in Morocco, in 1989, we had only 120 Arabian horses in the country. Now, with all that fields of development, with Arabian racing horses, we arrived to 3,000 horses.
Wow.
To give you an idea about
That's
the
incredible.
Gap between 1989 and today.
Well done. That is incredible. Well done, Morocco. No wonder you're getting so many good horses around the world. We've got a question coming in from a gentleman in the front row. Sir, tell us your name, where are you from, and your question.
This is working. Tom, thank you very much. My name is Dr. Khalid Hassan, and Director of Royal Arabian Stables in Bahrain. It is an honor for me to attend this World Arabian Horse Racing Conference. I thank all the committee organizing this conference. It's beautiful. For those who know me, I've been a lot of business circling with the racing horses and some endurance horses. From my background of Bahrain, which we have very fundamental desert Arabian horses over than 200 years, 250 years raising this kind of horses. And these horses, they are originated from 18 bloodline, which is give us a good view for breeding. Breeding is very important. And for those in you who's in this field and those they want to go on a breeding, I believe they have to be allocated the goals of a breeding because it's a breeding and not an easy. It is a need of patience, it's a need of time. And so it will be also to be concentrated what you want to end with the breedings. So it is the breeding is the end. You want to at the end with the horses, which is good investment for the farmers or for the breeders. I believe that it is... breeding is a very complicated technology right now. We have a lot of bloodlines where we are selected. In my country, as examples, from, as I said, 18 families, but there is a few of them, they are good for racing, but the rest of them, they are not good enough to be the champions or the winning. So the breeders, they should be concentrated on the bloodline, which they are have to be good selectivities.
Can I ask a question that I would like to know? You don't have the same grass that we have in Europe, Ireland, America, where it's all, there's a lot of rain, it's green, it's juicy, it's healthy. Is that a drawback, perhaps, to a foal being born? Would that detract from
his or her chance being born in the Middle East because the natural food is not as good? Or is, do we need advice here, national feed and everything like that? Where would you like to breed a foal, Europe, America, or the Middle East?
Good questions. I like it. You know, environmental is playing very important, and nutritional is very playing important. Raising horses in the Middle East, from my background and from our experience, it's not end with the good horses which is raising in Europe. The good feed, the good forages, the good ranches, it is in Europe and it's open. Uphill, downhill, build the engine, back engine of the horses, the young ones. The one we are breeding in the country is flat. Our country is flat. So what they gonna end with the end? The front muscles is working, but the back muscles not working. So all the horses are gonna see, notice that in the breed in Middle East, where it is in a flat, you have weak back muscles, but not in front. Front one is strong. The one we have brought it from Europe, they are strong in the front. Back to the feeding. Feeding is very important. Yep. It is important, really, because they have their all nutrients. And even though you have to select the farms and the places, yeah, as a part of south of Europe, where I noticed we have south of France, we have a farms there. Yeah. They are beautiful roughages there. The strong, the nutrient is very good. The north part about it, it is the it's good, but it's not as good as the south. You show the breeder have to select it where you have to raise their horses. If you pick it to for racing or for show or for the endurance, even like exactly. That. Yes.
Can I just put that to Kathy? Kathy, you're the expert on feed. Does it make any difference where a foal is born?
I think it does from the point of view that you need to know where your starting point is and what you've got, and then you have to tailor your feeding regime to that. So, for example, if we look at grass is really important in terms of energy and different nutrients. And if you don't have much grazing, if the pasture is not good, then there are many things that we can do to the diet, including particular types of forages, even things like hydroponic grass. But we need to think about maybe what's missing if we haven't got enough pasture there, and things like there's a lot of work being done on a particular form of vitamin K at the moment, which is involved in telling the body where to put the calcium in bone. So there may be individual things that you need to be aware of, and I think as long as you you know what you've got in terms of the baseline nutrition, you can adapt your diet in very many different ways to achieve the ends you're looking for.
Very interesting. We have a question coming in from one of the top breeders in France.
Oui, Marie-Ange Bourdette, Art de Montlot, à Toulouse. Je voulais dire ici, regardez, la salle elle est pleine et on est une famille, on est content. Et de plus en plus, il y a des jeunes. Et merci pour la chance qui nous est donnée par les Émirats Arabes Unis d'être là, parce que ça coûte. Vous savez, c'est pas n'importe qui, pas n'importe pays pour faire ça. Donc nous remercions tous ensemble les Émirats. Maintenant, je vais parler de l'élevage. L'élevage, c'est la chose la plus dure, parce que pour faire un petit, pour faire un enfant, comme pour nous-mêmes, c'est très dur. Moi, j'ai la chance de vivre à Toulouse, où la terre, elle est faite pour les chevaux arabes. Et elle est faite, le sol, même s'il n'y a pas d'herbe, ils vont vivre. Et je reviens sur l'élevage. C'est dur de choisir. C'est dur de choisir un stallion. Quel est le stallion que je vais mettre ? On met des fois 2 mois, 3 mois à réfléchir. Et une fois qu'on l'a mis, on dit j'espère que j'ai bien choisi. Parce que vous parlez de la science. Moi, la science, c'est nous. C'est nous, dans nos champs, à préparer, à aller avec la sueur pour pouvoir arriver 3 ans après pour essayer de gagner, de faire quelque chose. Et moi, par exemple, je vais vous donner un exemple. J'ai été vers Mungiz, j'ai été la première pour aller à Mungiz, mais j'ai regardé ce cheval, j'ai dit je suis sûre. Mais je suis sûre, et après, et j'ai bien choisi. Et je dis aux gens, Je vous souhaite à tous une bonne réussite, car le cheval arabe, il commence par l'élevage. Et là, on a une grande chance. Je remercie tous les organisateurs. Je remercie les chèques qui nous ont donné cette chance pour arriver. Et à tout le monde, et surtout à Madame Savoya, qui nous fait des choses extraordinaires. Hier, quand on était au Vatican, j'ai dit oui, le cheval arabe aujourd'hui, il existe. Et il existe avec vous tous. Merci.
Très bon. Absolutely superb. Okay, you want to come in to react to that?
Yes, I just wanted to say I love her passion and very well said. And that's one of the things that I, as a trainer, I love to work with owner breeders because it is like the long haul and you have to have the patience, but being part of that whole process, it's just a lot of... It's fun, it can be heartbreaking, and the lady just described it with her passion and her love, and it's always bordering on obsession as well. So that's me as a trainer. I love to work with owner breeders, being part of developing a family, and maybe getting the siblings in and seeing how they are, and it just, it becomes a way of life, and she said it very well.
She does, doesn't she? And you know what I love about her as well, her enthusiasm. Yeah. Whenever she has a winner, wherever it is, and she is one of the top breeders in France, she really goes for it. The jockey gets kissed, even I get kissed sometimes. And I look, we have another top French breeder alongside. Madame, would you please stand? Tell us your name, where are you from, and your question.
Good morning to everybody. I was Mrs. Koch from Southern France, and Maurice Studd. Again, I think... Marie-Ange had said a lot concerning the hospitality and how big was the way that the Arabian horse had taken with the help of the Emirate and Sheikh Mansour Al Nahyan and with the energy of Sarah Al Hawaya. I was very impressed. She was always at the top. As breeder, Marie-Ange, it's true that the mare was really important, and for the breeder, the feeding was also important. Sometimes you ask a question concerning the choice of a stallion, and you don't know why you use this one, and because it's your feeling. So I agree with her. But for the future of the Arabian, ask me myself a special question concerning the embryo transfer and also the insemination. We compare with the thoroughbred, but the number of the Arabian mare was really few in comparison of the thoroughbred. And as breeder, we start to do insemination and transfer embryo, but because of the market, we are using always the best mare who have produced group one winner, and some good one who have very good pedigree. Actually, we don't put now for breeding because we can't do all. And because we do transfer embryo with the best one, some of the mare was put away. And perhaps like thoroughbred, perhaps we will lose opportunity of the blood. Because sometimes in thoroughbred, there are group one winner, and we have follow and forget one or two generation. So actually, myself as breeder, it's really difficult to keep some mare, for me was one who have no performance, but that we don't use only because of the market. And actually, the owner ask us group one winner directly at the first generation. So what are you thinking concerning the inbreeding? You said Arabian horse, we have a lot of inbreeding, but if you use insemination, artificial insemination plus embryo transfer, perhaps we will have more problem of inbreeding. So I'd like to know what you think about that.
Who wants to react to that? Stefano, first of all.
I'm not sure I understand clearly the question.
Yeah.
So, I think at this stage, we cannot avoid to think about artificial insemination and biotransfer for the Arabian horses. And at the same time, I think it's impossible to make a comparison with the thoroughbreds for many different reasons: experience, tradition, market. So, I think we're still in favor of artificial insemination. We need that at the moment. What do you think, Andrew?
And the thing about artificial, the thing you mentioned about reducing the breeding and inbreeding, but in fact, with artificial insemination, you have much bigger choice of stallions and genes from other places. So therefore, it's again much better. Also, you mentioned about embryo transfer. Embryo transfer, is a very useful technology, but it's not that simple. I mean, you talk about older mares. In fact, there's a recent study about Arabian mares, and Arabian mares over about 15, 17 years, they reckon you're lucky if you get 20% embryos. So it's it is a technology that is more for younger mares, but you obviously can try it. Yeah.
I understand what the lady is saying, and I agree to, definitely agree, and you see it in thoroughbreds as well, that commerciality does kind of kill the breed, because I'm from Germany, and the history of German thoroughbred breeders, they always bred to race. So when you breed to race, you kind of do the right thing. When you breed for the market, you start doing the wrong thing for the breeding, and I think it is much more, acute in Arabians, because as we've agreed, that we need to conserve the bloodline. So we really need people that know their pedigrees and do the right thing and don't just always have the commerciality in the back of their head.
Breed to race or breed for the market? It's a very good one, but we all need some money to buy a cup of coffee, don't we? I'm coming back to you. Kath, would you like to say something? I'm on the way to the end. Kathy, your reaction.
Well, I think what I wanted to bring out was what she said about breeding to only using your group one producers. But I found in the United States, even in the thoroughbred bloodlines, a lot of them will breed unproven mares of exceptional bloodlines to really good stallions because quite often those mares produce well. Even, Federico Tessio said the same thing. It's not necessarily just the group one winners, because sometimes those mares never reproduce themselves. He mentioned something about leaving all their energy at the track. So I think you can't throw out those unrated or, mares that never, because of an injury or something like that, never made it to the track. I mean, there's example after example of top horses that have been produced from mares like that.
Interesting. The gentleman from Morocco, sir.
Yes, I heard about artificial insemination and blood transfer. It's no more than a technology, a scientific technology, to go faster in genetics. But what is important and the real motor of the development of Arabian horses is, of course, the races. If we have a bigger number of races each year, I am sure there will be a bigger market for the Arabian race horses. We don't believe that only the big races can be interesting, the big races for 1 million euro, but we can have more races for 5,000 euro, 10,000 euro, which can be useful to develop all the category of horses. To answer to a question to the French lady who speaks about the market, the market of Arabian horses today is small because the number of Arabian race horses in the world is small. So it's important to know to develop the Arabian horses. Thank you.
There's a gentleman here who was born in France. He's been in Oman for many years. He's one of the leading bloodstock agents. Sir, your question and your name.
Thank you. Jean-Pierre de Roubaix from France. As you said, I'm a bloodstock agent. So I buy horses and advise people about breeding. My question is a question to the breeders and to the vets that I have in front of me. At the beginning of the session, we spoke about which stallion to choose for my mare, which mare I want for my stallion. But I think we forgot to speak about something. How is my mare? Is she tall? Is she small? Is she strong? weak? Is she a nice, quiet mare, or she has a bad temperament? I think that the point number one is to know your horses. I think Marie-Ange Bourdette and Mrs. Koch, of course, you breed with love, a lot of love. But you have to know also how the stallions are. If you order frozen semen from the other side of the world, if you have no idea if the stallion is tall, small, or crooked, I think it's a mistake. So what do you think about this?
I think this is a very important point. In my opinion, a breeder, more than to know his mare the way she looks like, because it's quite obvious, should try to understand what his mare is passing to the progeny. A mare that is smallish is not necessarily a small horse producer. It strongly depends on what you mate her. Same for the stallion. You don't need to know mainly if the stallion is big, strong, correct, whatever. Yeah, this is an advantage. But when I choose a stallion for my mare, I try to look in the future and say, okay, my mare is producing this characteristic, okay? She's producing small. What I'm looking for, stamina, speed, precocity. What I'm looking for, long distance. I want to breed a classic horse. I want to breed a precocious horse. And then I start looking on the market. I look at the stallions available all over the world, okay? I try to have an idea if I know something about their production, okay? What are they producing? Short distance horses, fast horses, big horses, strong horses. And from there, I try to mate them.
Annalisa, what are your thoughts on this?
Penso che quello che diceva Jean-Pierre De Robé è sicuramente la fattrice per me, la cosa importante. È vero che lo stallone è la monta che ci costa, che dobbiamo scegliere, ma poi tutto parte dalla mamma, dalla fattrice. Io, se posso, mi riaggancio al discorso dell'embryo transfer. Sono le mamme che portano, come noi umani, per 11 mesi un prodotto che poi non sappiamo mai, fino a che non nasce, che cosa sarà. L'attesa è molto lunga e il fatto dell'embryo transfer, secondo me, è molto discutibile, perché per me, io dico la mia opinione, immagino che in platea ci saranno molti pareri diversi dal mio, ma questo siamo qui per parlarne. Il fatto dell'embryo transfer per me in purezza è un conto, non in purezza è un altro. Per me una mamma che porta un prodotto in gambo sicuramente trasmette non solo DNA, trasmette soprattutto poi il giorno che nasce l'imprinting che dà al suo figlio. Diciamo, un puledro che nasce da una purosangue araba e vive con lei i primi giorni ha sicuramente un imprinting diverso da una fattrice, secondo me, che magari non è in purezza, una trottatrice, qualsiasi altra razza, che darà al puledro che nasce come un PSA a tutti gli effetti, ma l'imprinting che gli darà la mamma non sarà mai quello di una mamma PSA. Io la vedo così.
Thank you, Annalisa. We have a question coming in from a lady from Australia. Please stand. This is a Group 1 winning jockey. Your name, tell us more.
Linda Meach from Australia. I've just got a question to Saba from Hungary. Just a personal thing. We had a champion mare, she died having a foal. Just the possibility of having the live embryo and transferring it to, so your champion mares, you're protecting them from, you know, dying from having the foal. Is it possible to take the live embryo and put it into, say, a not so good mare, but the egg and the sperm come from the two champions?
Wow, that's a good question. The gentleman, the professor from Budapest, what is your answer?
This is the sense of assisted reproduction. And it is practiced in endangered species as well. Like in deers, for example. If deers are shot at a fire range, even if they are dead, sperm can be taken from the epididymis, or oocytes can be taken from the ovary. It can be transferred to the lab, and if the time frame is pretty short, then there is a possibility to create an embryo, which then can be transferred to a foster mother, and can become a perfect foal. So this is what actually assisted reproduction does. So the answer for your question, if I understood it right, of course it is possible.
We have a question coming here from a gentleman with a very, very big hat. Go.
Thanks, Thomas. Good to see you again. My name's Michael Ralston. I'm the president of the Australasian Arabian Racing Club. I keep pinching myself. I can't believe I'm in a situation where I can ask these sort of questions to an esteemed group of people like this. But I see artificial insemination playing a huge role in how Australia develops its racing into the future. Unfortunately, and I'm sure we've all dealt with it, there are people with less scruples than us in this room in the industries. So, and this touches on what Mr. Sidretti said about the International Racehorse Registry. How do we know that the semen that we are getting is from the correct stallion? It all comes down to integrity.
I do apologise. I'm certain we got the answer. Okay, guys, come on. Please answer that.
When you breed your mare with the frozen semen, the imported semen, and the foal is born, the only way the foal can be registered is to have you to do a DNA test, and that's when you'll then prove that it's the correct semen you have. I mean, it's a worldwide thing, testing, you know, to prove parentage. So there's no reason why it shouldn't be. As long as you're buying from a reputable source, they'll guarantee it's coming from the right stallion. If you can prove after the foal is born that it's not the correct stallion, then obviously you can go back to your supplier. But have you heard of cases of this happening? Because I haven't really.
No. Well, it's an interesting question. I have the mic now, so you can't. DNA, I mean, DNA would say yes straight away.
Yes, 100%.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Yes. We have an answer coming in here, Kath.
I just wanted to come back actually on the question of the embryo transfer and using foster mares, because I think there's something that we need to think about there is, again, it's about compatibility of the foster mare, because things like milk production will vary between different breeds, uterine environment, uterine space, all of those things. And this can be either a negative or a positive. You can probably use that to your advantage, but again, it's about knowing what you're looking for and what you're dealing with.
The gentleman on your left wants to say something.
Not to answer to the question. The DNA of the foal proves the stallion from which it's bred. But what is important to speak about a great stallion or a great horse, there is a difference. You can have a great race horse who is not a good stallion. You can try a new stallion, but you are not sure that the product will be excellent. If you are lucky, it can be a good one. Because the heritability of Darwin proves that the stallion can take qualities of his mother, of his father. It depends. So you can have very good stallion who gives you with another mare very bad horse. So you have to try all the outbreedings possible and all the inbreedings possible to find the right way for your mare and the right way for your stallion.
We have another question from the front row. Sir, will you stand up and tell us your name, where you're from?
Thank you very much. Mohammed Al-Najafi from Iraq. My question is that I was interested in the frozen semen and the technology that has been developed. Has been any comparative study to compare the quality of the, specifically the speed gene, if the mare is covered naturally or by frozen semen? Does the same genes transferred equally, or it might be different?
It's an excellent question. The most important thing that during cryopreservation, the genes are not modified. They are kept. And this is why it's quite important what techniques do we use, that those genes are kept well and they can be exhibited well in the foal. So just to make a statement, cryopreservation does not modify the genetic material of the horse. It keeps it.
Thank you very much. Interesting. Sir, we have another question. Gentlemen in the front row. Sir, please stand. Your name and your question.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Ahmed Al-Yamahi from Imarat. سؤالي الأول بخصوص التغذية. تكلمت الأخت بأن تغذية الحشائش الزيادة عن اللازم هي مضرة للأمهار والنمو. أبغي فكرة الموضوع أكثر وما هي الكمية أو النسبة الذي لابد نعطيها المهر لنموه. الشيء الثاني بخصوص السيمنز، ما هي المدة المناسبة الذي تم تخزينه داخل النيتروجين أو غيره؟ شكرا.
Who would like to answer that? You're all going to put your hand up. Yes, Kat.
If I answer the grass question first, yeah. It varies. It varies tremendously. It depends what your grass situation is, and this, to an extent, is where science meets art, because with nutrition, yes, it's a science, but it goes in hand with the art of horsemanship, and it very much depends on your monitoring of your growing animals, so how well they're growing, what their growth rates are like, what they're looking like, are they looking overtopped, are they looking fat? And I guess the important thing is modifying their access to the grazing if needs be, if they're growing too fast or if they are becoming obese, which can happen. And then making sure that you cover the micronutrition through the bucket. So it's all about balance, and your horsemanship skills come into their own then in monitoring the progress of those animals as they grow.
Kath to Kathy.
Well, Kath is approaching this from a scientific and she's spot on. She's spot on. I have, in the United States, there are two states that are known for the grass, and that's because of the limestone content in the soil, Lexington, Kentucky, and Marion County, Florida. And it makes a huge difference in the type of, in what's in the grass and how it relates to the horses. And in the spring of the year, I know I'm from Michigan, and we have to test our soil yearly to make sure that we have all the right nutrients, because we have a tendency to lose lime, so we have to lime our soils. But because of that, I was telling Kath, I have excessive pasture, and so I have to really monitor my foals so they don't grow too fast and get too heavy, because the grass is so good. And we leave the grass grow long because then the sugar content in the grass stays at the bottom. If you cut it so your pastures look beautiful, then you've got all this gorgeous green pasture, but you have lots of sugar, and that's all they're getting at the top of the grass stalk
is that
sugar.
Right? Interesting.
And it creates obesity in horses, yeah. Which creates numerous other problems, insulin resistance problems, the list goes on and on. So Kath is quite right. You really must... Even if you have great pasture, you have to watch, especially growing horses, because you can blow out their ankles. I mean, there's so many things that can adversely happen to them because of that, because of the sugar, too much calcium. I mean, it's a juggling act, and you must read up, and you better know what you're doing.
It's very interesting. When I get on my little tractor, and I cut my lawn, if I cut it too short, it looks good. But it doesn't do it any good.
Not for the horses.
Interesting. Yeah, I like it. We have a question coming in from a lady at the back, a rather tall lady at the back.
Hi, Derek. Thank you. My question is probably both to Catherine and Kathy, and further to what Linda Meach here brought up earlier with regards to embryo transfer. Is it possible, and this will sort of pose a further question about the rules and the clarity of Arabian racing rules, with embryo transfer, is it possible for an embryo to be transplanted into another breed of horse? As an example, as Linda mentioned to me earlier, a Clydesdale, which quite often in Australia we see in a nanny mare situation. How does that impact on the rules of Arabian racing? Would that foal be able to race under the rules and regulations of all countries involved in Arabian races, or there are different rules for each country? And also, with embryo transfer, if we were to harvest one egg from a mare, and then of course put that egg to the semen of a certain stallion, but there are many eggs in the mare, can we take several eggs from that mare at once with the semen from the same stallion and produce basically many copies of the same horse and then transfer them into other surrogate mares? And once again, are those horses able to race under the rules of Arabian racing?
We have the answer coming in from the gentleman from Morocco.
So I think actually there are big differences between the countries. Each country decides on the way they are going to use the embryo transfer. but normally it is open to all kinds of embryo transfer, but it's not open for the same race to have the same foal issued of embryo transfer of the same mare and the same stallion. That's the decision in France. But sometimes you can have two embryos in the same time in the mare, and there is no reason to lose one, because it's good to have one horse. Maybe one could be very weak and the other is better. So it's genetic selection, not more. So it's a technique. Don't consider it as something which is out of normal, natural rules of reproduction. It's only a technique.
Yes, I agree too. The recipient mare is the foal is developing inside the recipient mare, but the foal is no genetic link to the recipient mare. And most countries, they don't state there's no problem with any type of recipient mare you want. Except you may have a big mare may produce too much milk. I think there may be some people, some registries that ask for them to be only in Arabian mares. And in fact, in our program, we only use Arabian mares as the recipients because as the lady mentioned earlier, you know, for the imprinting of the foals, it does seem to be better. And you were talking about getting eggs as well. I mean, if you get the ovary from a male that's died, it's very difficult to get to harvest the eggs, but it can be done. But you don't actually get that many. I mean, it's in theory it sounds very good, but technically it's actually quite difficult to do. But you can fertilize the eggs. This ICSI it's called, which is intracytoplasmic, is like IVF, and it is possible to be done. But there's only a few centers that do it. The main thing is really you have to have a facility who can do these things, and often the facility isn't closely available, especially if you have a sad situation where a mare dies during foaling or from colic or something.
We have just over 5 minutes left to go, so we've got time for two or three more questions. Sir, please stand, your name, your question.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I will talk in Arabic. Ahmed al-Mazroui, مربي خيل عربية في دولة الإمارات. عندي سؤال بخصوص الأفحل. إذا كان عندي فحل عربي أصيل ومنتج وأنتج أبطال وقمت باستنساخ هذا الفحل دون معرفة من الجهات القانونية أو الرسمية وأنتجت من هذا الفحل، هل هذا الشيء قانوني وهل يمكن القيام فيه أو لا؟
That's got an incredible response straight away. Who wants to answer that? Come on,
one of
you got to.
You have to follow the regulations of your registry.
Yes.
Your registry. I don't think there's any registries that allow cloning. So obviously it would be illegal to do it. But if your registry allowed it. But I don't think there aren't any registries that allow it at the moment. Yeah.
Ah, we have a question coming in here from a young commentator. Sir, your name, tell us more.
Ibrahim Al-Hadrami from Sultanate of Oman. My question about the embryo transfer technology. Do you think it is it can make or it can do any improving with Arabian horse racing, or just only for short way to good business? In general, what are the positive and negative aspects from this kind of technology? Thank you.
Very good question. What are the positives? What are the negatives, guys? That's a guy who loves his Arabian racing. I've seen him in action. Come on.
The positive is the fact you can, instead of taking 4 years to produce four foals, you can, if you're lucky, produce three or four in 1 year. So then you can compare them quickly. Obviously, it's negative if you make a bad choice of, of your mare and your stallion, because it's obviously a relatively expensive process if you don't produce a good offspring. But it's just a technique, as our colleague said. It's not it's not nothing negative.
The gentleman from Morocco is very keen to answer this.
Easy. We don't see embryo transfer as something which is going to destroy the Arab horse genetics. It's only a technique to go faster in genetic selection. So it's not, there is no problem. And we have no big issues about that because the first ones have been done during the last 5 years. We'll see in some years when the horses will race, when a lot of horses will race, what is the consequences of that technique. But in other animals, species, in other species, it has been successful. In milk cows, in pork, in everything, it has been successful.
This lady is also not just a trainer, she's a veterinarian.
Yeah, I just wanted to say, because Annalisa touched on that before, and I think it kind of went under, that the imprinting part, I think that is a very interesting thing to think about. Hmm. If it is with a foster, because you already know that when you have a when you get a horse in training that was a foster foal and you don't know about it, you're like, what's wrong with it? You know what? He's acting different.
Honestly,
so yes,
really?
So you can really tell that with that. So with embryo transfer, that would happen all the time. So I wonder. I don't have any experience with offsprings of embryo transfer, but I think that is maybe a bit of an issue. The imprinting, and they're going to be growing up with a completely different type of horse.
That's
as a mother for a very important time of their life when they're being raised. I don't know.
No.
Maybe somebody can say.
Well, we've got time for two more questions, sir.
أنا سعيد الهناي من سلطنة عمان. أولا نود أن نشكر مهرجان الشيخ منصور. نود أن نشكر دولة الإمارات. نشكر إيطاليا على استضافتنا في هذا المؤتمر. تطرق الدكتور محمد نجفي لسؤال مهم جدا ونرغب إجابة من المولدين. هل إنتاج حصان بالسائل المنوي المجمد والفرش يعطي نفس الجودة نفس الكواليتي breeding from fresh semen and frozen semen if give same quality in the racing? نعلم أن الإنتاج من بيطريا الإنتاج من بالسمن المجمد والفرش يعطي نفس النتيجة كحصان لكن هل بنفس الكواليتي في السباق؟ هذا سؤال الأول. سؤال الثاني إذا كان لدي فرس متخصصة professional in short distance وسباقاتي في بلدي مثلا مسافات متوسطة أو مسافات عالية فهل أفضل أن أبيع هذه الفرس أم أنتج من حصان يركض مسافات عالية وشكرا لكم.
Thank you very, very much indeed. That was good. Just quickly, we're running out of time. I'm just trying to get two more in. Sir, your question or your thoughts.
السلام عليكم. محمد البريكي منتج من دولة الإمارات. أود في البداية أشكر الشيخ منصور بن زايد لإتاحة الفرصة للحضور في هذا المؤتمر ولله الحمد الإنتاج في دولة الإمارات أثبت جدارته في كل الميادين ونحن في دولة الإمارات دائما نتطلع أن نكون من الأوائل شكرا.
Well done. Thank you very much indeed. And one final. This is the very last. Young lady. Okay.
Good morning. I'm Val Bunting from Secretary of WAHO, World Arabian Horse Organization. I'd like to put the record straight regarding registrations. Cloned horses are forbidden to be registered in any WAHO stud book. Also, any foals produced by IVF are not registrable. Thank you.
Wow, well, well done. There you have it. Now that's a great way to one final. Sir, your name, please stand up just quickly. We're running out of time.
Okay, thank you very much. I wish to thank everybody who was behind this valuable conference. My name is Said Wafa from Libya. I would like just to ask any advice from the experts of nutrition during the breeding season, say for the stallion during the breeding season, and for the brood mares before covering and during a pregnancy and after falling. Just any advice, especially for countries, Middle East and North African country like our countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that's a good question, good to have you here. Who would like to answer that? Come on guys, you're the experts. Come on. Yes.
And was not, let Andrew answer.
Andrew? Andrew, answer the gentleman's question.
Yes, about the quality of fresh and frozen semen, for what I can understand. Basically, the freezing process does put stress on the semen, and therefore it's more difficult to get mares in foal using frozen semen, and you have to get them closer to ovulation. But the actual offspring is fine, because basically it's got to be a cell that is viable, that fertilizes the mare and produces a healthy offspring. So you will get the same, if you produce a foal, it will be the same quality as using fresh semen. And I think that's been proven over the years. And there's also another comment about the mares for an embryo transfer, the recipient mares. I mean, this is, I think it's been looked at a lot as well. And I think it is, you want to try and get a mare that is similar to the, if you can't get the same breed, one that's a similar breed. And certainly if you use some people have tried to use very large mares, and then they end up with too much milk and problems with the foal, how the foal's developed. If you use a very small mare, you'll usually get a smaller foal as well. So it's, as I say, we use Arabian mares in our program, and I think that's, you try to use the same breed is good, yeah.
Well, I think we've had a very, very good discussion. Anything you guys would just want to say, has anybody got anything that they want to say that they wish they'd have said? Just answer that, Mr. Morocco.
A small answer for the fast stallion.
Yes.
If you have a fast stallion, just keep it, because they are the best for the production. As it is done in thoroughbreds, the best stallions are the milers. They are not the stayers. So it means that you have a fast horse, it can always put some progression on your mare.
Thank you very, very much indeed. Ezzeldine Sedredi from Morocco, Kath Dunnett, United Kingdom, Professor Cesca Prebensky, Hungary, Annalisa Landucci from Italy, Kathy Smoke, United States of America, Ilka Gensler-Levesque, Germany and United Kingdom, Stefano Daneri, Italy, and Andrew Dugdash from Scotland. Ladies and gentlemen, can we give them a big round of applause and say thank you. Absolutely outstanding. So that is the first session. After lunch and a bit of relaxation, we go live at 2 o'clock, Rome time, and that is next with racing and training. Stacks to look forward to. Stay with us.